Hey you guys, and welcome back to That Disney Girl. So it's been a hot minute since I've been able to chat with you guys, and that's because I've been in Disney World. And when I was in Disney World, I got to go to my first ever Epcot Food and Wine Festival, and I'm here today to tell you all about all of that. So as a first timer, I'll run through all of the food that I ate, as well as all of the foods that my friends have eaten with me, and then we'll just talk about what I would rate them, what my friends rated them, and what you should look forward to if you are heading to the festival for the remainder of this season. And since this is That Disney Girl's channel, of course we gotta throw some history in there. So let's start off by talking about the history of Epcot's Food and Wine Festival. So in the early to mid 90s, Epcot was not doing too hot. They really wanted to increase their guest count, especially in the fall season, so they were looking at ways to try to do this. Now the president of operations back in 95 was George Kalogridis, and you might recognize that name because George Kalogridis is currently the president of Walt Disney World. Well, I mean, I guess kind of the president, he just got a promotion, so he's gonna become head of the Disney Institute, but we're not talking about that. You might just recognize him, and that's probably why. So it was Kalogridis' job to find a way to boost attendance at Epcot, so he started finding out other ways that other companies were getting people to come to them. And one of the things he studied was a festival in Aspen, which was not too different than this one. It was literally called the Food and Wine Festival, and it drew a lot of guests. So they decided to bring this to Orlando, and at first they tested a small version of this in what we now call Disney Springs, and after that they brought it to a Hilton Resort in Orlando, and in both locations it did amazing. So Kalogridis thought, literally, what other better place to put it than Epcot? You can go around the world and you can taste foods from around the world. So the point of this was pretty similar to what we see today, and it's basically the same as any other festival that you're gonna get at Disney when you go to Epcot. Basically, you are gonna be able to walk around the pavilions, and each pavilion would have a smaller booth. In there, you could taste different foods and wines or different drinks that country would provide for you, and it was gonna be on a smaller scale, and the prices were gonna be way cheaper. I mean, when it started, prices ranged from about $1 to $3 for food and drinks, so it's a lot different than what you get today, from around $4.50 to maybe upwards of $9. And they did start introducing countries that didn't have a pavilion in Epcot. Some of the starting ones would have been countries like Greece and Poland. So this kind of started and spearheaded the beginning of Epcot's biggest festival of the year. And when it started, the festival was as short as 30 days, which is way shorter than what we see today. I mean, this year in 2019, we have a record-breaking count of the Food and Wine Festival days, and that is 87 days of duration, so a lot longer. You can see that the festival has obviously come a long way because guests like myself and you love it. And one of the last big portions of the Epcot Food and Wine Festival is the Eat to the Beat concert series. Now when you come to the festival on certain nights, you're gonna get to see a performer or a group perform 3 times in that evening with a whole set of songs. And these performers are usually people that are slightly past their prime or people that kind of had one-hit wonders. And although it seems like this could be something that targets a middle-aged crowd, as someone who is 24, I had a great time going to the Eat to the Beat concert series. We'll talk about that later. But let's see where it got its name from. So in 1979, Blondie came out with an album called Eat to the Beat. And a lot of the Disney execs really had this name stick to their minds, but they didn't do anything with it right away. And then after the terrorist attacks of 9/11, tourism, of course, definitely dropped in Disney World, and Disney wanted to find a way to invite guests back to the park and let them want to enjoy the experience of Disney again. So they decided to kind of come up with a new thing, and they really loved bringing performers to Epcot. You can see all throughout the pavilions, there's performances happening all the time. They wanted to make this special to the Epcot Food and Wine Festival, so they decided to make this Eat to the Beat concert series, where you are going to be able to get contracted performers into the park, so basically a free concert, and you can eat and drink while you're watching them. And one last little fact about the Epcot Food and Wine Festival is, you know that train that's right by the Germany Pavilion, one that you definitely know Walt would have loved? Well, that is actually something that was added in for Epcot's Food and Wine Festival, but has sat there for about 20 years now. So it's stuck around, and now it's just become part of the park, so something that we can thank the Food and Wine Festival for. So the way I'm gonna do this, I think, I'm gonna talk about the foods and the drinks that I had, then I've gotten my friends to write up some quick little synopsises of the food and drinks that they had so that I could talk about what they liked. And also, I think that their input is important because although I did try many foods, I don't eat meat. I do eat fish, but I don't eat chicken or beef or anything, so by having their inputs, we can look at all of the foods at the Food and Wine Festival. So let's get started. So first we're gonna start with the Wine and Dine Studio. This is gonna be right when you're entering the World Showcase, just before you do that. And here I had the coveted butternut squash ravioli. So this is butternut squash ravioli with brown butter vinaigrette, Parmesan cheese, and pumpkin seeds. All of the different vlogs I've seen about the Food and Wine Festival, it seems like this is a staple dish, and it was definitely very good. I really liked the way the vinaigrette was there on top of it because it kind of gave it a tangy flavor when the butternut squash gives it a really sweet flavor, so I definitely liked it. I'm a saucy person, so this was obviously very lightly sauced. It wasn't really sauced at all, just the vinaigrette on top. I would get it again, but I don't think that it was a standout dish for me, so I might be with the unpopular opinion here, don't think it's bad, but wasn't the best thing, I think, at the festival. If you do like ravioli or you want to try something that everyone says is great, I definitely think you should still give it a go. But when it comes to my opinion on it, I'm gonna give this one a solid 7.5 out of 10. So now we're gonna jump even deeper into the World Showcase and head to the Alps booth. Now this is a booth that just is premiering now in 2019 for the first time, and one of the items on here I was so amped for. It was probably my most excited item at the Food and Wine Festival, and that is raclette. If you don't know what raclette is, this is basically Swiss cheese that's melted and put on top of things. And in the case of the Food and Wine Festival, you're gonna get two pieces of bread, you're gonna get some little potatoes, and two little baby pickles with this raclette poured on top of it. Now, I am definitely a huge cheese lover, that's why I was so excited about this dish. But when I had it, kind of fell flat. I'm not saying it was bad, I still liked it. I mean, it was melted cheese. But the thing about this cheese, and I think this is just Swiss cheese in general, is that when it's melted, it kind of tends to harden up really quick. And when I talk about quick, I mean like within 15 seconds, this thing was getting pretty hard. We did get it late at night when the wind was starting to pick up, so maybe that might have been a factor for it. But because the wind was starting to pick up, they made every dish ready to order when during the day, they're just gonna melt a bunch of cheese and put it on top of your dish and it's gonna wait under a heating lamp. And I've heard some negative things about that because then it's not as fresh. So I did get it fresh and it was still good, but even fresh, it did seem to tend to harden quickly. So I don't know if fresh or sitting under the heat lamp makes too much of a difference when it comes to the meltiness of the cheese. I think it was good, I just think I had really high expectations for this one. So I'm gonna go ahead and give it a 6 out of 10. Honestly, I don't think I'd get it again if I went. So in Germany, in the Brewers Collection section, there is going to be a pomegranate beer. I would destroy the name if I even tried to say it, but obviously you can see it on the screen right now. And I think this was actually such a good beer. It was super light, so if you don't like beer, I think this is kind of like teetering on the side of cider. So something that you can try, but it definitely still has a beer taste. It's not too much of a juicy flavor. This was only gonna be $4.50, and it has a portion that's about yay big, so it's gonna last you just a couple minutes, but it's definitely good to get that sample size and you could taste it. One of my friends actually went back for seconds. People on Instagram were messaging me saying that they loved that beer when they were able to come to the festival. So if you're thinking about trying a beer in the Germany Pavilion, definitely go for that pomegranate one. I would love to get it again. And out of 10, I'm gonna give it a 8.5 out of 10. So in the American Adventure Pavilion, we went to Hops and Barley, and over there, they're gonna have that New England lobster roll. So let's look at what is included with that. You are gonna get some warm lobster with fresh herb mayonnaise on a griddled roll. And this is going to be for $8.25. So probably the most expensive item that I got at the Food and Wine Festival, one of the more expensive items that I think even exist at this festival. But it is lobster, so in my mind, I kind of understood why they were doing that. Now I actually have kind of two reviews for this one because we did get it twice. Earlier in the day, one of my friends got it, and then later at night, I got it. So during the day, I got to have a quick bite of my friend's, and the lobster was warm. There was lots of mayonnaise on it. So if you're not a big mayo fan, maybe steer clear of this one. I love mayonnaise, so for me, it was great. I really, really liked the roll on this as well because it was kind of like a thick brioche egg bread, and you can tell that it was griddled. It wasn't just like a piece of stale bread on there. So I think that makes a difference. It seemed like it was well put together. And for my one bite, I really liked it, obviously, because I went back later that night to get a second for myself. So here's where things started to fall flat for me. Now the pavilions close at 10 p.m. I got this at 9:30, so a lot of these were just kind of made ready to order. So it seemed like because they were closing, they just kind of pre-made a few, which is fine. But when I took a bite of mine, my lobster was so cold. It was like ice cold, which is still not bad. I mean, cold lobster is still really good. I was just expecting warm lobster, and that's kind of what they marketed as. So that was a little bit of a bummer. But I think the bigger bummer was that it was not mayonnaise on top of my roll. It was kind of like a tartar sauce. There was a really, really strong tang in there, the same sort of tang that you get in a tartar sauce. So it was kind of off-putting for me. Then because the lobster was cold, it was starting to get chewier than normal. I didn't even finish this entire dish, and it was $8.25. So for me, for that high price, I'm gonna have to give this dish a 5 out of 10. I think it was the worst thing that I had at the festival. But then again, if I rated that bite from earlier, I would have given it an 8 out of 10. So if you get it during the day, I think definitely something that's worth it. If you get it later towards the evening when it's starting to get cold, pick up those winds. I don't know, maybe it's steer clear. And at this booth, I also tried the Angry Orchard Rosé Cider. I never tried rosé cider before, and I love cider. I love rosé. I thought it would be a great mix, and it was really good. It wasn't too strong in flavor, and plus, it was only $4.50. Definitely something that's worth it. If I saw it at my local grocery store, I would definitely pick it up. Over in the Japan Pavilion, I was able to get the spicy roll there, and it was so good. It's a salmon and tuna sushi topped with volcano sauce. That volcano sauce is basically a spicy mayo. We've already clarified, I like mayo and I really like spices, so the perfect combination. I really liked the inside of it because it was kind of like they were mixed up all together. It had a really meaty flavor in there. And the only thing about this one is it's not cut up sushi. It's kind of like a long roll. So if you're looking to share this one, or if you want to eat it, separately, you're gonna have to cut it yourself. But I think that it was so, so good. It's definitely something that's gonna be topping my list of food at the festival. I thought this was a perfect portion. 8.5 out of 10. And in Brazil, I had the infamous cheesy bun bread. Cheesy bread, I don't know, whatever you call it, that cheese bread in Brazil that everybody seems to rave about. That's what I had. So this is going to be $4.50, and it actually comes with 2 pieces of the bread. So if you were expecting one, you're gonna get 2. I know I was expecting one and I got 2. So that was a little bit of a happy surprise for me. But by having 2, it's definitely something that's gonna fill up your stomach. So if you're trying to make it around the whole world showcase, you might not be able to finish both of them. I wasn't able to, but I do think you get the value for your money in this dish. And if you're wondering what is the Brazilian cheesy bread, it's literally that. It's cheese inside of bread, and it's so good. The bread was kind of like this gooey texture, which I wasn't expecting. I'd seen someone else eating it, and it looked like there was like cheese oozing out of it. So I was like, yep, I'm in, I'm sold. But then when I bit into it, it was almost like the cheese and the dough that's kind of spilling out into it. It's a different texture, and something that might sound a little bit weird as I'm describing it, but it is actually really good. And these buns were warmed up. There's nothing better than warm cheese. I mean, you're not gonna get crazy special flavors in here. It's gonna be kind of bland, but I think it's something that could appeal to anyone. I'm gonna give it an 8 out of 10. It was really good, great portion sizing, and yeah, something that's gonna be just really tasty. Now let's head on over to the Shimmering Sips Mimosa Bar. I was so excited to head towards this booth because I love mimosas. So when I went there, I got the flight of mimosas, and that's gonna come with 3 mimosas for $13. So let's look at what those 3 are. The first is a tropical mimosa with sparkling wine and passion fruit, orange, and guava juices. The second is a key lime mimosa with key lime sparkling wine and cranberry juice. And then the third is a blood orange mimosa with sparkling wine and blood orange juice. So from looking at this, I would have thought my ranking would have went from the tropical mimosa, then to the pomegranate mimosa, and then the key lime mimosa. But when I actually started having them, the key lime mimosa seemed to be my favorite. I really liked this one because I found that the cranberry juice with the white sparkling wine, it wasn't overly sweet. There was still kind of like a sour cut in there, and I could somewhat taste the alcohol. It wasn't being overpowered by sugar, so I really liked that. The tropical mimosa was actually really, really good. That one was obviously my second choice, and I thought it was delicious, but it was really sweet. Those juices were really taking over the wine, so sometimes I just felt like it was a little bit too much sugar for me, but definitely something that would be really good with a brunch. And then the third is the pomegranate mimosa in my eyes. There's gonna be pulp in this one, which I love pulp, but if you don't love pulp, maybe steer clear. I'm just not the biggest fan of pomegranate. I do like it, but out of the three, it's just not my favorite thing to have. I definitely liked it. I finished the whole thing. It was super, super good. But if I'm going in my rankings, we're gonna go key lime, we're gonna go tropical, and then pomegranate. And I do think that the value for the flight is well worth it. It's $13 to try all three. If you want to get one individually, it's going to be $6. I mean, the individual ones are slightly larger, but I do think that you definitely get good portion amount sizing for these three mimosas. I don't think I could have drank more of them. It's a lot of sweet liquid to take in at once. And then if we head towards Earth Eats, which is once again towards the beginning of the World Showcase, I was able to have the Impossible Slider Burger. Now, I've already mentioned that I'm not someone who eats meat, so I've definitely had my fair share of veggie burgers. I've had Impossible Burgers, Beyond Meat Burgers, literally any kind of veggie burger you could think of, I've had it. And I'm gonna say that this one is possibly competing for one of my favorite veggie burgers, like, ever. So this is going to be $5.25, and it's the burger slider with wasabi cream, spicy Asian slaw on a sesame seed bun. Now the burger is gonna be kind of like a mini burger slider. It's not a big portion, it's gonna be kind of smaller, but I do think that the patty itself was really thick and large, so you're gonna get a lot of food, even though it seems like it's a little bit smaller. And I think one of my favorite things about having this burger was every single time that I've had a veggie burger, I've gone somewhere that makes veggie burgers, it's always been a frozen patty. But at this booth, I literally saw a bucket of what would be like your fake ground beef, and they were actually making them into little balls, just like they were doing over at the other pavilion booths for their burgers. They were making the burgers as they were going, putting them on the grill, and then cooking them ready to order. So that's not something that I've ever really seen before, and I was really excited because I got to taste like a really, really fresh veggie burger. And like I just said, the portion sizing on it was huge. I think that wasabi cream sauce was super, super good. I love the Asian slaw. And inside of that patty, it kind of had these spices that I've never had in a veggie burger before. Even in other Impossible Burgers, I've never tasted those spices. So I don't know if it's a little bit something different, if it's like Disney magic just getting into my head or anything. But I really, really liked this burger. It was so good. I'm gonna give it a 9.5 out of 10 just because this is something that I like to try in my everyday life. And for it to top all of those things, since I've had it so many times, I definitely think it's something you should get. And for people who are kind of being curious on this new craze of like impossible meat and fake meat, I think you should give it a shot, especially if you do eat meat. And I mean, even if you don't think it tastes like real meat, I think you're still going to enjoy it. So definitely stop by Earth Eats for that one. And right by Earth Eats, there is Coastal Eats. So this is all gonna be kind of like fish dishes. And this had something that I was really excited to try, and that is the Pacifico True Striped Bass Tostada with slaw and fire roasted tomatillo sauce. And this was $6. So you're basically gonna get this piece of bass on top of like a crispy tortilla shell. There's going to be that cabbage slaw on the bottom there, and then a tomatillo sauce to top it off. And I think it was really, really good. I really liked this dish. I thought that the piece of bass that I had was actually really good. It wasn't dry, which is something that I was scared about since, you know, they're making so many of these to order. But in the end, it was actually really good. And I really liked that tomatillo sauce. It kind of gave it a zest that wasn't there without it. And then the slaw on the bottom gave it a little bit of a crunch. The only thing is that like tostada crispy tortilla thing, it kind of makes a mess because you break it like a cracker. So the fish that's, you know, kind of falling everywhere and that slaw and the sauce, you really need to be eating it like on top of something or maybe using like a fork or just to kind of help you get pieces of what's on top of the tortilla back onto the little crisps that you're breaking off. But I think for $6 to have a good fish dish, it was really good. I'm gonna give this one a 9 out of 10. And I am going to be saving my favorite dish for last, and this is going to be at the Cheese Studio. Obviously, can you sense a trend here? And that is going to be hosted by Boars and Cheese. And if you've ever had Boars and Cheese, oh my god, it's so good. I love Boars and Cheese. So this was a booth that I knew was going to be a hit for me instantly, but this specific meal is what I fell in love with. So I had the black pepper Boars and Souffle with fig marmalade on it. Now, I am a huge souffle fan, and I thought that this one was possibly one of the best souffles that I've ever had. I loved the Boars and Cheese on here. I've never had a souffle with Boars and Cheese before, so that was really delicious. I really liked the black pepper on there. It kind of gave it a spice, and the fig marmalade, oh my god, getting any kind of jam with cheese is so good, especially when it is cheese that like is kind of like in a souffle and it breaks apart so easily. It was just really warm. It was light, but it had so many flavors and like two different textures going on. If you like cheese, if you like combining sweet and salty, I think this is literally the perfect dish for you. I would definitely recommend it. This is the one that I will give a 10 out of 10 to. So if you like this sort of thing, if it sounds appealing, even if it kind of sounds semi-appealing, I would definitely recommend this one at the Cheese Studio. So those were all of the ones that I tried, but let's quickly recap what my friends tried and see their ratings on it. So if you are interested in any of these other dishes, you could give it a shot as well. So if we're gonna stick at the Cheese Studio, let's take a look at one of their meat dishes. That is going to be the braised beef stroganoff with tiny egg noodles with wild mushroom boursin, garlic, and fine herb cheese sauce. So basically what I got from this one was that the piece of beef that you're gonna get in there is gonna be pretty big. It's a hearty meal. It's definitely something that's gonna be filling, especially with that creamy sauce that's gonna be on top of there. My friend said that she could have done without those little tiny egg noodles. I actually even remember her saying that. So if you like egg noodles, then maybe this will still be a great dish for you. She said it was still really good. It was something that she'd like to try again. The beef, like I said, cooked very well, and she gave this one an 8 out of 10. If we pop back up to Coastal Eats, we also tried the crab cake from there. So the crab cake is a lump crab cake with Napa cabbage slaw and avocado lemongrass cream for $5. So I didn't try this one, but it seems like it's a good crab cake. It's not gonna be the best crab cake you're ever gonna get in your life. It's not gonna be filled with too much crab in it, and that the slaw is really good, but it's a creamy slaw, not a vinaigrette slaw. So if you have a preference between those two, maybe that could affect your decision if you wanna get this meal, and that the avocado slaw sort of sauce on the top there was super good. The crab cake was made with mayo, which is quite popular when you're gonna get a crab cake. It usually is what kind of holds the crab together. They use it as like sort of a glue. And my friends really liked it. One of them likes mayo, one of them doesn't like mayo, and even the one who doesn't like mayo said that it was really good, wasn't too strong on that mayo-y flavor. And they both gave it an 8 out of 10. So at Flavors from Fire, they got a couple of dishes, and the smell from this booth was so good. If you like that barbecue-y smell, this is definitely something that's going to be pulling you in. So let's check out what that booth had to offer. So you could get the Steakhouse Blended Burger. It's gonna be blended beef with a mushroom slider and a brie cheese fondue with arugula and a truffle blue cheese potato chip on a brioche bun for $5.25. So apparently this burger was really good. The patty's gonna be cooked well. My friend really liked the addition of that chip inside, and the only criticism she had for this one was that it wasn't enough brie on top of there. So if you're a big brie fan, I know I'm a huge brie fan, so if I was having this, I definitely would have also liked to have lots of brie on there. So because of that, and also it's kind of a smaller portion size, she's gonna give this one a 7 out of 10. You can also get the smoked corned beef with crispy potatoes, cheese curds, pickled onion, and brie cheese fondue for $5.25. And basically the review was that this is one of the best things that my friend has ever eaten. So if you like this sort of thing and it appeals to you, it's something you should definitely get. Plus the portion of this thing was gigantic. It was piled up so high, it took two of them to just finish it. It's definitely gonna give you that value, and you're not even hitting $6. I think it's probably the best value you're gonna get for anything that we tried, or anything that I've seen literally anybody try at the festival at this point. Apparently cheese fondue and corned beef work really well together, because she gave this one a 10 out of 10. If we hop to the Wine and Dine Studio, we also tried a couple things there. I actually tried this dish as well, but it wasn't mine. This is going to be the seared scallop, truffled celery root puree, Brussels sprouts, and wild mushrooms. So my friend said that the scallops were cooked perfectly. I actually really agree with this, because I find that sometimes scallops could be a tad bit chewy, and these were not chewy at all, which thank God, they were so good. She said that that puree was a little bit like hit and miss. She wasn't the biggest fan of it. But in the end, this dish still landed a 8 out of 10. So over in Thailand, they also tried the shrimp and cold noodle salad. Now for this one, it's gonna get a little bit of a lower rating. Not too low, but they're actually pretty generous in their rating. So this one got a 7 out of 10 from one and a 6.5 out of 10 from the other. And this is gonna be because the portion sizing is quite small. They both agreed that the shrimp on here was good portion sizing, but the noodles was a lot smaller in relativity to the shrimp that you're getting. and it just seemed like it was a okay dish, just something that's a little bit basic. You're not gonna get too many flavors coming from it. Apparently it had a little bit of a sourish taste, but was refreshing if it's a hot day. So if this is something that appeals to you, maybe still go ahead and get it, but doesn't seem like it fared too well on our rating this time. In Japan, we got the teriyaki chicken bun. This is going to be a steamed bun filled with chicken, vegetables, and a sweet teriyaki sauce for $5.75. In this one, the filling is delicious. If you like teriyaki sauces, definitely something for you. The bun itself is a little bit dry, so you definitely need to be eating it with that filling. And this one got an 8 out of 10. It's something that if I ate meat would definitely appeal to me. I'm a big sauces person, so if you're like me and you like those sauces, give it a shot. Let me know what you think. And then I'll quickly talk about the Eat to the Beat concert series. I got to see the Bahamen, which if you don't know who they are, they're the guys who sang Who Let the Dogs Out. It was such a great performance. They were definitely well rehearsed. They got the crowd going. I thought it was so, so much fun. It made me really have a great end to the evening, and it's something that I just can't wait to come back and do again. So I hope that you guys learned a little bit something about the history of the festival. You got to learn about the different foods that are available, a couple of drinks, and I hope that it helps if you're planning on going or if you have gone. Let's have a discussion on what foods you had, if you had what I had. Let me know if you agree with me, disagree. Let's all have that combo down below in the comments because I am so not over talking about this festival. And if you enjoyed the video, you gotta make sure that you give it a nice big thumbs up. If you like any sort of Disney content, especially history related, make sure that you subscribe to the channel for that content every single week. But for now, I will see you real soon. Okay, bye everyone.